Each year, thousands gather on Sunday afternoons across the United States to play men's recreational softball. With players ranging from college standouts who have never made the pros, to average Joes with the skill level to match, and everything in between. Some play to relieve stress, while some play to live out their childhood dreams that one day they'll have the opportunity to step up to the plate and get that clutch hit. For this team based out of Long Island, New York, it's about one goal, winning a championship. For the next hour, we'll take a look back at the 7-year journey for this team as they quickly rose from the bottom of the standings to becoming contenders and finally winning their first championship. With interviews from players who have lived it, Wet Humor Films has been granted this rare look inside the Ball Breakers.
David Goldstein,
Tim Ahmed,
Rob Bianco,
Brian Howard,
part of the 2015 champion Ball Breakers,
part of the 2015 division champion Ball Breakers,
2015 champion Ball Breakers,
part of the 2015 championship team.
This all originated from us playing baseball at Woodland. All my friends live near the middle school, and that's pretty much had been our safe haven for weekends. We would always play sports there, whether it be, actually it's only between football and baseball. We'd spend our springs playing behind the school. It's some nice fields over there, larger than what we would play here.
Well, as you know, we all used to play together, you know, seventh grade, probably even earlier. We would all play on Saturdays together as a team. We'd play against each other. You know, we got to the age where we wanted to be able to, instead of, you know, dividing ourselves up and playing against each other, trying to form a team together. And Dave was able to find a league. He found ABA.
We were sitting around in Dave's house one day, hanging out, a bunch of us, eating pizza in his backyard, and said, what can we do fun in the fall? And we said, you know what, let's start a softball team. We started drawing stuff up on a piece of paper outside on his back table.
So Joe Klobis is actually my brother-in-law. I've known him since 2008, and he's played on numerous softball teams before. He's won numerous championships, and he kind of sparked my interest in it. And I knew that we had a bunch of athletic friends that we've, you know, I've been around for years. Luigi, Andrew, Tim, you know, Brian, Bianco, guys like that. So I brought the idea to them, and I said, what do you guys think about getting the softball team started? You know, we've always played sports in high school and middle school, playing, you know, organizing baseball games on Saturdays, but never anything really organized, always just kind of amateur on our own stuff. So we signed up for it, and it's funny because Brian and Bianco actually were 17 at the time. It's an 18 older league.
Well, it's actually a funny story. It turns out that we were both 17 at the time.
We didn't even know if we'd be allowed to play. It's an 18 and over league.
So we had to get our parents to sign a waiver to give us the right to play.
I actually had to bring the piece of paper to my mother and have her sign it. And so did Brian. We did it on the same day. And we had to fax it over to manager David's house.
That was our first year. I needed mom's permission, which is, you know, pretty funny. You know, we were the two young guys on the team.
We didn't know what we were getting into.
But obviously they were able to let us in, and, you know, we fit pretty well with the team.
I hated playing in the infield. I was always scared to get hit by a ball. So even when we played Saturdays at Woodland, I would play in the outfield. I felt safest over there. So when we had our chance to pick positions, I'm like, all right, I want to play the outfield. I think I have the best chance.
Looking at the fielding how it is now and the fielding from 2009, it's funny because it's complete opposite. If you look at that fielding now, you would say, what were we thinking? You had
Raf Flores was maybe our first pitcher.
Me in right field.
I think Luigi was at third.
Tim in right center field.
Bianco was first, so maybe Andrew was in left center.
Bianco, even though he's a very good first baseman, you had him at first base.
Vic was catcher. Yeah. And Raf was pitching.
Yeah. You had guys completely out of position.
First game comes along against the Bombers. Supremely nervous. My heart was beating so fast. It was just weird. Playing on this field behind us, it just felt even larger than ever before.
You know, obviously a little bit of nervousness. You know, pretty excited, obviously, to go out there. We never really competed together, you know, that kind of level. So a little bit, you know, like I said, we were anxious, nervous, ready to get out there. We finally get out there. I remember the first out.
And then he threw one over the plate that got crushed to center.
That ball was sailing high and fast.
I'm in right field. Tim's in left field. I'm sorry, Tim's in right center field.
And then in my vision, I'm watching the ball, and Tim comes right into my picture and makes an acrobatic catch like I've never seen him do.
I've known Tim for a long time. I've known him to be a freak athlete, have ridiculous ups, you know, in basketball. So he jumps up, makes the catch, hits into the fence, and I think we were all thinking this, all 12 of us out there on that, you know, on that team.
Hey, you know, maybe we can hang around, you know, maybe this is something that we will be good at.
I don't know how I made that quick reaction to just run as far back as possible. Luckily, I made it just in front of the fence, caught the ball, and as I caught it, I just stared into my glove because it was unimaginable. I think Dave was also playing outfield at the time, and he was surprised. We felt like we were gonna win the champions that year, or win the championship that year. It was amazing.
Then in the bottom of the first, after that, we were, you know, getting up to bat. I was the leadoff hitter, got a single, so I guess I was able to get the first recorded ball breaker hit. We got on first base, and pretty sure I got stranded there.
First time I stepped in there, I thought, this is gonna be a piece of cake. I went from guys throwing 80 miles an hour in high school to coming out here and thinking these guys are just lobbing it in, this should be a piece of cake. And on my first swing, I swung and missed.
Game rolls along, I believe it was the Bombers were playing, and we're getting slaughtered. We really were so far in over our heads. I believe we actually signed up for the C level. There's A, B, C, and D. A being the best, D being the worst. And we signed up for C thinking, you know what? I think we're a little bit above that like real low bottom, rock bottom level. Let's see if we can kind of make out in the C division. And we were so far out of our league.
I think we lost 13-0 in the first game, and we went through probably 5 or 6 pitchers. I ended up having to pitch a couple innings also, coming in from the left field. So it was definitely a little bit of a rude awakening.
Our main thing was to find a pitcher, because it's something none of us had ever done before, and it's, and, you know, if you don't have a good pitcher out there, it's sponsoring a walkathon for the other team.
Yeah, I don't know if it was after the first game or the first week of softball, but eventually I'm like, all right, maybe this is something that I can actually be pretty good in. So that time we used to practice on Saturdays, days before games. We would come along. We would actually practice right here. I said, let me toss it a few times.
Yeah, we found out Tim could pitch, and Tim was good at it. And we were trying to figure out what positions worked best for us, who was our outfield, who was our infielders.
I got a good feel for it after just doing a simple tosses, no spin. I've been able to get a side spin along, try to backspin it sometimes. But then I was getting a feel for it. I'm like, wow, I could not only play this position, but make it interesting.
And, you know, it took a few games just to even get that sorted out. So the first half of the first season was pretty ugly before we started getting things together.
Team went 4-10 that year. And it was definitely, you know, that a lot of, talking about growing pains, that was growing pains.
Well, I remember that, you know, obviously 4-10 was not a playoff kind of record. It turns out that two of the teams shouldn't even have been in our division. They ended up getting moved out.
Opening up a spot for us in the playoffs. So even though we didn't earn the playoff berth, we wanted to use it as experience.
And we got into the playoffs on a technicality and played the team that we played here on that first game that blew us out.
So that ended up putting us in the 4 seed. And so just like that, we were able to get a playoff berth. I remember, you know, didn't really earn it, you know, at a 4-10 record, but we definitely went out there and we competed our asses off that first playoff game in our first year.
We go in there, it's a best 2 out of 3 series, as all the playoff games are. We lose the first one, we win the second one, and that kind of built our confidence. You know, it was a bunch of peaks and valleys that season. We went from the first play with Tim thinking, here we are, going to the championship, to getting mercy ruled, slaughtered. It's amazing that we even won 4 games that season with just how inexperienced we were as a whole.
We came back from a come from behind win in game 2, We played a tight game three and didn't come out on top, but it really was a heck of a finish, and it inspired us to keep this team together and moving forward.
Well, I think, you know, to be honest, the first season in the fall, you know, like I said, we didn't really earn that playoff spot. So I think it was still in the summer, we were still trying to find the identity of, you know, who we were as a team. You know, we still were trying to figure out positions. We still didn't really have a lineup. We were also, you know, it was our first time really playing, so we were all trying to figure out, you know, what each player was, what they can bring to the team, and, you know, how it kind of meshes together to make us, you know, who we are and what we, you know, became and who we are now.
You know, at 8-14, we're still getting used to the league, still finding ourselves. I mean, now we're into a rhythm where we have positions, and even till this day, positions change a lot, but guys are starting to find their bats, they're starting to find their positions in the field and all that. We're starting to know who plays where, who really has no business playing in what position.
We had about an eight division team, league, whatever we were in. We ended up finishing fifth or sixth, a couple games out of the playoffs. We weren't happy about it. Down the stretch, we just couldn't put those last couple wins together to secure a playoff spot. But it was part of the growing pains, and we just got hungrier for the next season.
Summer 2010, we didn't know it at the time because it was only our second season. We were still so young into it. But looking back and knowing that we've made the playoffs every single season besides for summer 2010, something about that just kind of bothers me because we didn't know at the time how we would go and how things would play out for the Ball Breakers. But looking back now, I wish I'd just be able to just make the playoffs that season.
I don't think Joe Klobis was in the team before. And we had him for the first time, and I guess we got a good taste how it feels like to have a more older player on the team, an experienced player. And we had newer bats. We felt better on the field. We got better hits.
Well, I mean, obviously having him, someone who knows, you know, what it's like. He's been playing the last couple of years experience. I guess, you know, he really was the role model. He brought that veteran leadership to the team, and we were all able to look to him, you know, to see kind of how you're supposed to play. You know, some people come out there, they think you just want to have to crush the ball every time. Turns out sometimes getting a little base hit down the line or, you know, a little gapper to the other side, you know, it gets the job done. You know, also walk is as good as a hit. So, you know, I think having Joe around to show us, you know, what we're supposed to do, how the game's supposed to be played really helped, you know, to form our team and our identity.
And then we go on to the fall. We make it to the championship. So we go from being a team that made the playoffs on a technicality, we missed the playoffs, and now in just our third season, we are going to the championship. So that's huge. This is what we set out to do since day one. I don't think a lot of us thought that it would come so quickly, but the fact that a lot of us were fast learners and just talented, athletic players, it's no wonder that we made it to the championship even though we would lose that season.
Well, we played screwballs over the season, and we thought, you know, they were pretty good. We had trouble playing them. But the last time we played them at the end of the regular season, we split with them. We had a nice big win. We run-ruled them, and then they came back and won the second game in a crazy 45-30 shootout. But we went into the playoffs thinking, if we have our minds right, we could beat this team. But again, we won the first round, and then we just didn't come out on top in the playoffs.
Once again, I think we found ourselves, you know, kind of overmatched. They were a much better team. They had a lot of good guys that could hit. But, you know, we always found a way to hang ourselves in there. You know, we never really got out of it. Another high-scoring game. You know, they scored 6 runs. We answered right back with another 5 or 6 runs. It was back and forth the whole time. And once again, it was a little bit of a disappointment. You know, obviously being the championship for the first time, you know, wanting to taste that gold, wanting to hold that trophy up and, you know, really know how it feels to be the, you know, the champ. And it just didn't, you know, that was our first, you know, real heartbreak.
Go on to the championship. We versus Screwball. Screwballs were a team that were at the top really all season. You know, we were able to play well against them. Losing in the championship hurt because it's one thing to miss the playoffs or to get knocked out in the first round. Okay, you know that you probably didn't deserve to be there. But when you make it to the championship, and you're right there on the cusp of it. You can, it's within your grasp. and you don't have it, it definitely hurts. So it took a lot out of us. We benefited from it for sure, but it hurt not to be able to take that one home. And after that, we kind of had a chip on our shoulder from there on out. Our goal was to not just make it back to the championship, but now to win it.
So the first championship we experienced was, it was kind of magical in some ways because we've never played at Caniag Park before. It was a really nice field. It was a night game. It wasn't one of those games where we would walk in just before sunset. So the lights were on. It was almost the same feeling like our first game, just the field was bigger. There was some serenity to it. It was just kind of peaceful to look at. I remember we even had a crowd. We never really had that. And to have people behind us, rooting for us in what could have been our first championship, that was kind of amazing. We even had somebody taking pictures. It felt legit.
You know, being in there, it was a cold day. I think it was November, late October, early November, so it was definitely cold. I remember wearing the thermal underneath, the t-shirt underneath that, jersey on top, sweatpants, shorts underneath the sweatpants. It was very cold, but, you know, obviously you had to push through it. And, you know, once again, it just came to that point where we fell a little bit short. But I think after being in that championship game, we kind of knew that, you know, we can hang around. You know, we can give teams runs for their money. They want to underestimate us, that's fine. We never minded being the underdogs coming in. And honestly, I think our team is better as an underdog. You know, don't expect much from us, but then all of a sudden, we'll come at you.
Yeah, it seemed like we had a really good chance of making a run that year. I don't know what happened.
2011 was a tough year for us. We had just made it to the championship in 2010. We lost. Now we're in 2011. Summer comes along. We get knocked out in the first round.
Well, it felt like a step backwards. We thought we were going to come back and get back to the championship and take what we thought was ours. But it didn't work out that way. Again, part of the growing pains. It was also we had guys come and go, so we didn't really have the exact same team that we had the year before. So it was a little different for us, but it was all about making adjustments, finding positions for guys.
We finished 15-9 that season. So that one really killed us. The worst part about that, I feel like, was that we're versing Los Diablos, so we kind of had some bad blood with. We had some benches clearing, altercations with them.
I think that's when one of their, I guess the first baseman, ended up chasing Matty Ice with a baseball bat. So that was kind of our relationship with that team. You know, there's definitely some bad blood there.
Los Diablos, they were just a pesky team. We didn't like them one bit.
Yeah, I think there was a play at second where Robbie slid into second, and then he came up and he ran into him. So the guy took his glove and smacked him in the face. So that team was just, you know, they were a bunch of hotheads. We really didn't have a good relationship with them.
Yeah, they got into our skin. I remember games at Randall Park where I would be pitching and they would be taunting me. And at first it's like, all right, it's just white noise. And then after a while, you start to feel it. You start to feel nervous. And they, you know, looking back at it, there's nothing wrong with that. They played the game the right way. It was just not a way that people would like to play it, or enjoy it at least. Yeah, and it affected our team mentality. We were up and down.
We have a seven-run lead. I'm sorry, we have a lead in the seventh run of both games, and we blow it in both of them.
Well, you know, obviously having two leads, seventh inning of both games, and coming out on, you know, short is not the way you want to go out. Obviously, we had, you know, two playoff first round losses, and I felt, you know, this year against Los Diablos, they're definitely a beatable team. Should have been something where we could have taken them out, could have held on to lead, but, you know, they outdid us that day and they went on. I don't know if they ended up winning the championship that year. I don't think they did. I think they ended up losing because they weren't a better, you know, they weren't really a good team.
So now we're thinking, what's going on here? You know, we were riding high. We made it to the championship last season, and just one of those collapses. I mean, every team goes through it. You still see, you know, the Yankee fans, myself, we're still trying to figure out how we blew that lead to Boston in, I believe it was 2004. How did things like that happen? Sometimes in sports, things like that just happen. This was our moment for the ball breakers, blowing those leads in the seventh inning of both games.
You know, obviously losing to them in the seventh both times was also a real, you know, it definitely stung knowing that we could have beat them.
Mm-hmm.
And we wanted to beat them bad, you know, after what they've been doing to us.
Every year when the schedule comes out, when our teams that are in our division come out, first thing I do is contact Luigi. Luigi watches ABA, which is our league we play in. He watches the teams very closely. The teams in not just in D, which is where we play, but in A, B, C. He watches them all. He knows a lot of these guys. Luigi's played in tournaments. He's filled in for other teams before, so he knows a lot of these guys. So I look at him and I give him a list of the teams and I say, tell me what's going on here. What teams are we going to have trouble with? The teams that we're not familiar with, because we have a lot of teams that we've seen over the years. Two Schmalls was one that I was not familiar with.
The Two Schmalls were, I felt like they had illegal bats. It had to be. I mean, yeah, those guys were strong to begin with, but they would have the softest swing and that ball would go miles away.
Yeah, we weren't happy about it. They're one of the best teams in the country, and we went out there and they gave us a little bit of, not a reality check, but we kind of questioned whether or not we should go forward in this league if we thought we were going to play teams like that.
Luigi immediately, bad news. He said this is going to be really tough. These guys do not belong in our division. The fall is always tough. Fall is hard because a lot of the teams don't play in the fall, so the commissioner has to mix and match and try to do the best he can to make things fair. Of course, not always going to happen, and the fall of 2011 was a perfect example of that.
Their shots were super. Those line drives came in super fast and super hard. I thought Andrew might get a few more busted lips playing with them. It was unfair. I don't understand how they always played in our division. They had the bats of the team in the A division or in the A league.
Yeah, I remember that year was a rough year because we kind of went into it already knowing that, you know, if we went all the way, we're gonna have to play Two Schmalls, and they were, you know, they're a B league, A or B team. They had no right being in our league. We really got fucked over that year, to be quite honest. You know, it just sucked because even coming into the season, you know, you always want to have high expectations, knowing that you could, you know, take it all, and we wanted to do it, and then just knowing that we had this big, you know, monster at the top that no matter what we did, even if we made out of the first round and we'd have to face them, that they were just the team that was just completely better than us. You know, sometimes you got to admit when a team's better than you, and they really were. They're a top team in, you know, the whole ABA league.
However, we did make the playoffs in a tough division, and it was at the end of the season, just making the playoffs and being there with those guys, it felt good to end the season on a high note, get knocked out by Two Schmalls in the first round, but we did play well down the stretch.
So Two Schmalls, as expected, run through the division. We wind up meeting them in the playoffs. We get knocked out in the playoffs by them. It really was not fun knowing that you're going into a division where you really don't stand a chance. Not because we didn't have faith in ourselves, but just because of how talented they were and how much better than they were in all levels. I mean, 2011, you got to remember, we still only have four seasons under our belt, which is not a lot compared to some of these guys that are in their late 20s, early 30s that might have been playing for 10 years already.
So to have them in our division, it was just kind of, you know, a low blow. We didn't even really have a chance, and you know, it was just another heartbreaker where we felt like we, you know, if we had a chance, if we had a real division where we could have taken, you know, a team out at a competitive level, then it would have been fine. But to have such an over, you know, match of a team.
Summer 2012, we come back. We're still a little salty about how the league put us with two schmalls in the fall, but that's behind us now. We're ready to go out there and make a statement. We made a statement, 19 wins that season, which to this day still stands as the most wins we've had in a season.
19 wins, that's amazing. I mean, just to imagine how many games we play during the summer, how many weeks really. It gets a bit frustrating after a while if you're not doing well. But for us, everything was working in our favor.
It was a good summer for us. You know, we had a really strong season. You know, obviously 19 wins is still our franchise record. I don't think we've had a summer as good as summer 2012. So when you look back at that summer, you know, I think we were the one seed coming out of that.
We had a very good regular season that year, and we thought we were going to, you know, try to go in and take the Peaches, who gave us some trouble. We went into the first round. We handled it well. We won. We swept the heavyweights.
We go on to the championship, play the Rockford Peaches.
I mean, we were the favorites. But going into that match, knowing how we resulted, it's unfortunate. It's terrible.
A team that we played a lot throughout 2011, 2012, we saw those guys a lot. They knew us, we knew them, and we felt like, okay, 2010, we made the championship, we lost, we're here now, we have that experience, we've paid our dues at this point. 2012 now, we really feel like we've paid our dues.
And that was just a year where, you know, we had such a strong beginning. You know, everyone was playing together. Everyone, you know, at this point, we've been around for 3 or 4 years. So we were all knew what everyone was bringing to the table. We knew what we could do. We knew what we were able to accomplish. And I think by that point, after having such a strong year, we really felt like, you know, this is it. We're going to make the run. We're going to break the curse. We're going to finish this season strong. We're going to win a championship. And then to lose to them in a disappointing fashion is just, you know, another story about how the Ball Breakers just kept fighting and came up short at the end, unfortunately.
We didn't bring it. We didn't bring it, and they took home the title, and we went again with another disappointing season, unfortunately.
We've gone through missing the playoffs. We've been knocked out in the first round. We've blown seventh inning leads. We've pretty much been through it all at this point. Now it's time to buckle down and win this championship.
So we were playing the Goon Squad. Beating them would take us back to another championship. The bases were loaded, but we only needed 2 runs to win the game.
To be honest, I don't have too much of, you know, the amazing memory of that year.
I stepped up to the plate, and usually I'm not the kind of guy that likes to swing on the first pitch. I'd prefer the walk, if anything. But I said, you know what, I'm just going to go for it. And I swear to God, it was the best feeling ever, knowing I hit it to the other side of the field.
But I do remember Tim hitting that walk-off, though.
I don't remember the entire series, but I remember that moment.
And, you know, for a guy like Tim, you know, he really surprises you sometimes. You know, you don't really expect too much. He's always out there, you know. He's more than okay with taking the walk. He'll get a single, you know, when he needs to.
The way this field's designed, it's not one of those that has fences. There was another softball field opposite our end. I wish we had fences everywhere we played, because hitting a home run there is the best feeling ever, over the fence. But in this case, we had another field.
But for him to come up clutch in that kind of situation to really, you know, put us over the top and advance us in the next round was huge for us. You know, we were all obviously jumping, going crazy.
Winning it for us. Getting the walk-off and then going into the championships. But that should have been counted as a home run, a grand slam, if anything. But that was probably, from an individual standpoint, my best moment, one of my best moments.
For that, it was a, you know, big moment for us in our history, big moment for himself as a player. You know, he really, sometimes he's got that clutch factor, which, you know, you can't teach it.
I do know before our hiatus, we played Showtime. And they were one of the top teams in the playoffs. Losing to them, I guess, helped us lose our interest in having another season together.
I had things going on in my personal life that I wasn't able to play at the time. I had to step away from the game. And from there, the team, I guess, chose not to continue on.
I think it makes you realize just how quick something can go away, unfortunately. Playing with those guys for so many years, so many seasons together, and then all of a sudden it just stopped. You know, it was a low blow, and I wasn't really sure if we'd ever, you know, come back and play again. And, you know, to not know if we'd ever, you know, be able to all go out there together. You know, there's obviously that core group of guys that, you know, have been playing with the Ball Breakers since the beginning, and to not be able to go out there with them was you know, was heartbreaking.
It was frustrating. We thought the Ball Breakers were on the upswing. We thought we had a chance to, you know, turn this into a championship team. Then we went, you know, then we had a bad falling out for a year or two, where we, you know, the team kind of broke apart.
Well, you know, it was kind of disappointing. We kind of stalled out a little bit as a team. We weren't able to get together.
Yeah, it was a weird feeling. At the same time, while we were playing with Ball Breakers, we're also doing, we was also playing in a flag football league. So I guess some of us were more committed to football at the time, or we just didn't want to play softball at the moment.
We ended up having Luigi and Andrew made a team called the Wads.
It was a hybrid team of players from Ball Breakers, some friends we had from high school, people we knew, and they played a few seasons together.
It was a good team, won't lie. We had a decent run. It was another disappointing season, though. I remember we were a 1 or 2 seed, ended up getting knocked off early in the first round when we felt like we could have taken it all. So it kind of just built onto that, you know, Ball Breakers story, you know, always just thinking that we could do it, coming up short.
Well, yeah, I don't know if Manager David knew this, but we were playing in two leagues, Tuesday night and a Sunday, thinking that we were thinking, you know, all right, we could just play for both. And then the Ball Breakers kind of went south, unfortunately, and the Predators were on the upswing.
That actually, we have a couple of guys that are on that team now that play for the Ball Breakers. We have Minucci and Rosner that both were on that team.
We started playing in a weeknight league for the Predators. We won a champion. Brian and I won a championship with them, along with our DH, Anthony Minucci.
That was when, you know, I was actually able to win my first championship as the Predators. We had a crazy year. Matt Jaklich was also on that team. We had a lot of good guys on that team. It was a fun team to play with. Some big moments. Vic Soto was our pitcher. He ended up pitching in the championship game.
We always knew in the back of our mind we have to get the Ball Breakers together to take back what we believed was ours.
Summer 2015, so we're away for about 2 to 3 years, and finally my schedule opens up to where I'm able to put everything back into softball. And I don't want to jump into it kind of half-assed. I wanted to go into it wholeheartedly, and if we came back, we knew this was it. We had to get it done.
It seemed as if we could probably come back. Maybe the same friends we've had from the first Ball Breaker seasons would want to come back again and give it a second try at a championship.
I mean, I felt like we always had that core group of Ball Breakers that, you know, we had the potential. But I think when we had the additions of Romeo, Falco, Vin played for us in the championship, and also Rosner coming onto the team, and Minucci also that year, mm-hmm. I think was his first season. So having them come on to join our core, to have these kind of additions, you know, they brought stuff that we never had before.
It changed the energy in our team. We realized towards the end we had guys, we had a good core, David, Tim, Luigi, Andrew, myself, Bihau. We thought, you know, what are we missing here? We needed to add a couple pieces that just the right fits to the puzzle, pieces of the puzzle.
Brian and Rob, they brought Minucci. He would come at times to our Ball Breaker games, but this time we would have him as a full-time player.
You know, Romeo is a great hitter. He plays left field solid, never makes an error. We had Falco, great pitcher. He gets it over. He also is a good hitter. And then we had Rosner, who's also a great fielder. He gets the clutch hits. And, you know, Minucci is our big bat. He's able to clean the bases when we need him to. And, you know, he knows what he comes out to the team to do. You know, he's our big guy. He's our DH, so, you know, he's expected to hit. He comes out there and he could really drive the ball. So it's, without having those additions, I don't think we were able to pass even the threshold that we've always just been getting stuck at each time. You know, having those additions were just key.
It really changed the energy of this team, and once they joined, it was sad to see guys like Mark go, who had been a part of the foundation, but you know, sometimes you see people come and go, but sometimes it's for the better, and as soon as they joined the team, we hit the ground running.
So the 2015 team starts, we're on a roll. I mean, it's really like we haven't left. You know, now we know what we're doing. We're seasoned veterans, if you want to call us that. We're out there. We have one goal in mind. A lot of things fell right for us. We had a very fair division, a division that we could definitely compete against. And, you know, the weeks are going by, and we're in first place. We're clicking. Our defense has been probably the best it's been.
Yeah, so we already know how great our defense can be on the field. But when our offense is doing well, when we're getting our bats together, it's a different story. We're unstoppable.
Our offense, the bats are hot, and we're rolling right along.
Well, you know, it started off really great. We were beating teams. We were sweeping teams. I don't remember. I think we were like 8-2 or 8-3, like something like that to start off. You know, we were really hot.
It was a roller coaster. We started the season on a high note. We were in first place after about 7 weeks or so. Looks like we were going to cruise through this division, finally get our chance to go to the Diamond Cup.
If there's any season that proves how we have our ups and downs, 2015 was that season.
And then we hit a wall. It looks like some guys got tired, some guys had to miss a couple games. You know, some people were disagreeing on some things, and we fell off for about 3 weeks or so, and then we realized, hey, we still want to make the playoffs.
We had moments where we're like, all right, this team wouldn't go far. I think Gonzalez got suspended that year. Yeah, he definitely got suspended that year. We felt like, all right, our chemistry's not working. Some guys aren't going to feel it. We're not going to make it. But our defense was a key component to every game we played. And whenever you get your hits together, it's a different story. We were definitely the all-star team for some period of time.
And then we kind of hit a patch where we were just losing games each week. You know, we were losing to teams we should have swept. We were splitting with teams that we should have, you know, could have beat both games. Disappointing. And then we just kind of felt like that team that started off in the beginning so hot was the team that we really were.
Something that I think we realized that there was a panic button that was hit. We knew that our window was kind of closing. Not because the team was going to break up, we had just gotten back together, but because we cannot continue this trend of getting knocked out in the first round, making it to the championship and not winning.
So we came together as a group. There was a big group message that went on. We came back out. We won 4 games in a row, I believe, and we went into the playoffs hungry, even at the 4 seed, knowing that we could take this division, even with being the last seed in the playoffs.
How about it?
So the team has this saying that the best players, the best 10 are going to play on the field come playoff time, no matter what. A few days before the first round of the playoffs, I get a text from Luigi saying that the team has voted. They decided that Rob's going to play first base for the playoffs. Really nothing I could do to argue with it because the team voted. You know, you have to stick to that motto of what we've said, that the best team, the best players will play in their positions. You know, I definitely tried to be a team player. I was definitely supportive of it. Of course, I want to play in the field. Nobody comes and shows up just to play DH, to swing the bat a few times and go home. So that was really a big ego hit for me. You know, I was the first baseman for a pretty decent amount of time. And now to be able to see the game from a DHing standpoint, it was hard for me. It was definitely hard watching from the sideline, so to speak, for the playoffs.
You know, the first round, you know, going in as the 4 seed, my mentality going in is that if you're in the playoffs, you know, it doesn't matter what seed you are, you get in the playoffs, you have a chance at it. You know, the home field advantage is nice, but, you know, it's not essential to win the game. So we all knew that going in that we were a team that we could have been a 1 seed. It didn't really matter to us. We just knew that whoever was in our path that year, they were going to get knocked out, and we weren't going to take no as an answer.
We played the Regulators in the beginning of the year. We beat them, then they beat us. So we knew it was going to be a dogfight the second we got in there. But when we had this ball breaker team back together, the energy was high. We knew if we could take game one that we could win that series. And we had a dogfight game one. And we came out on top by two runs, by a catch made in the outfield. Bases loaded, two out. Guy hits a ball deep to center field. Sliding catch for the victory. We took game one, and we knew we weren't going home that day. And we got it done in game two with a blowout. And we headed back to the chip.
We made it back into the championships again. I think this time we reiterated how much we did not want this to be the same story. We've been here twice before, but this time we want to come in as the victors.
It's funny. I felt a bad omen before the game. We were all sitting there kind of talking around home plate. And, you know, Rob Gonzalez taking a few cuts with the bat, and he takes one full swing.
All of a sudden, we just hear this big clock, and I was like, holy shit, what the hell just happened?
It's definitely not his fault. No one should have been around him, but for some reason, Jaklich was just behind him. Robbie swings his bat, full extension, and the end of the bat hits Jaklich in the mouth.
I look over, and I see Matt has blood gushing from his lip coming down, and it turns out, I guess, Robbie was taking a couple practice swings, and Matt, you know, Matt's doing Matt. Gets in the way, gets clogged, bleeding from his mouth. You know, obviously, I'm fine. I'll go out there. I'll do my thing.
Unfortunately, I couldn't be there for the championship, but I was texting my teammates the whole time, wishing them luck, knowing that they were going to get the job done.
Well, obviously, you know that saying, the third time's a charm. So for that, you know, we got one in there. We had the experience. We knew we could do it. It was just a matter of execution. I do remember that game, that series very well. It was a rough one. We ended up losing the first game by a couple runs, and the bats were flat, and, you know, you just have that feeling where it's like, wow, is this really just all happening again? Is it just going to be another one of those seasons where we come so close and then just let it slip through our fingers?
And I'm thinking, here we go again. You know, this is you know, third time's not going to be a charm. We're going to go into the championship again, and we're going to walk out empty-handed.
The first game, it was... We saw our negatives. That really showed we weren't feeling that great. I did. I think that was the one game where I made all four hits and everyone else didn't. I'm like, really? It has to be a game like that where I'm actually doing well and no one else is. It actually hurt my confidence a bit.
And we all brought it in together for the game two. We had a discussion before, and we said, listen, like, This is our chance at it. We can't just keep letting these games slip by. Let's get the bats going. Let's make a statement.
Balls deep, they seemed like they looked like they should have won based on the first game. We were just out of whack. But the second game came along.
We come out in the top of the first. I think we scored six runs. We threw it right down their throats. We let them know that we're not going down without a fight. I remember they answered back, and pretty much we controlled that whole second game. We won with a pretty good fashion, won by a couple runs.
And now we're heading to that decisive third game, which now our confidence is building, and that carries over into game three.
I remember once again we started the first inning with a 5-run inning. You know, we really pounded it down, we set the statement, and I think, you know, we kind of ran away with the third game.
And here we are, just lighting it up. Left and right, shots fired over the outfield, over the infield, bloops. It was chaos for the other team.
We were definitely up by a couple runs. I think we had a nice, like, 8-9 run lead going into the bottom of the seventh. They were the home team. Falco goes out there, starts pitching. We get into a little bit of trouble. I remember two or three runs scored. We had a couple errors. You know, we just know we just needed three more outs. It's all we needed.
We're up by a good amount of runs. We're feeling comfortable. We're ready. You know, we're all ready to storm the field. We get the two outs. I believe Falco walks a guy.
Bottom seven, two dead. Runners on first and second. As balls deep is threatening the ball breakers here in game number three, a 14-6 lead for the breakers.
I'm watching from the sidelines. First pitch, I believe it was a ball.
We have a comfortable lead, but balls deep has been threatening with three so far in the bottom half of this inning.
Falco gets ready.
Ball on the outside corner. Here comes the 2-1 count.
And I'm just thinking to myself, you know, just hit the ball to me. You know, I wanted to make that catch. I knew I was ready for it. I'm just sitting there asking for it. Please, just hit the ball to me. I'll end this for us, and we can go on and win it.
Driven out into left center field, Howard.
I make the catch. We all go crazy. It was a little bit of a shoestring. I remember leaning down for it, but I knew I wasn't going to let it slip.
Races over, makes the catch. And for the first time in their team's existence, the Ball Breakers are champions.
Now, I feel like this was one of the most metaphorical moments in Ball Breaker history because Brian has always been a reliable guy. Brian's there when you need him defensively. He's come through with the timely hits. He's been a clutch player. And I was happy for Brian to make that catch. I thought that if there was a player on the team that really deserved it, it was Brian. And to have him be the one to make that final out, I know it's important to him. I know it was a big moment for him. And it made me proud. I was definitely happy for Brian.
That feeling was amazing knowing that I closed it out for the team. Everyone ran over to the middle. Andrew kind of walked over. You know, we won't knock him for that. He took his sweet-ass time coming over to celebrate.
They mob Howard out in short center field. Asdahl slowly walks over and slaps hands with his teammates.
Guys, I remember, like it was yesterday, guys are all behind second base. They're all high-fiving each other. We finally did it. Sometimes when things happen in your life, when these big accomplishments happen in your life, they don't kick in right away. Whether you're starting a new job, you know, you get a promotion, or whatever the case is, they don't hit you immediately. But for some reason, the moment that Brian caught that ball, that was it. You know, there was no adjustment period. The Ball Breakers, we could now say we were champions.
You know, so many years went by where we came close to winning the championship and losing it. You kind of forget how great that feeling might be. So to actually nab one in that fashion, just in dominating form, it was an awesome feeling. It's one that's really, it doesn't do justice just describing it in words. It's something that you would have to be a part of and actually feel. That was definitely a good night.
We went to the dugout. I remember Dave popped some champagne, so that was fun, being able to take a little champagne shower to win the championship.
And I checked my phone at the engagement party I had been at shortly later. After they started, and I got a text message from our manager, David, saying, we're going to the Diamond Cup. And that put a big smile on my face. Even without me being there, I would have loved to have been there to experience this with my team, but especially being one of the first ever guys on the Ball Breakers, one of the original members, it was so nice to see that we got the job done, and we won 2 games in a row to take it from Balls Deep.
As Dave Goldstein and company can finally say, since 2009, that they are the champions in ABA softball. As for the first time since 2012, their only other championship appearance, they're able to close the door. The two teams high-five each other just like in the Stanley Cup playoffs. Nice sign of sportsmanship for a group that was in first place most of this season. Started to slump off, stuck their way into the playoffs as that 4 seed. They played some of their best softball in the postseason.
I mean, obviously for me, I kind of look at myself as a leader for this team, playing with them for so many years. You know, I have high expectations for myself, both as a batter and a fielder. You know, there are times where we're in a tough stretch. I just want the ball to come to me because I know I won't let us down. And, you know, obviously it just means a lot knowing that I was able to seal the deal for us, make us champions, bring that trophy home. And, you know, obviously this is something I won't, you know, ever forget, having this ball right here. I remember kept it in my glove for a couple months, and I had to give it back to Dave. I said, listen, when you get the trophy, you know, put it on the glove. Obviously, you know, it's a big moment for us, this ball right here. So it was very special.
They'll forever go in as a part of history. You know, put in the Ball Breakers Hall of Fame. These will always be synonymous.
So after the 2015 season and after a nice showing in the Diamond Cup, we found out that one of our unsung heroes of that season, Matt Jaklich, who was our shortstop, we had some trouble finding someone to be a solid guy there. He stepped up halfway through the season and said, I'm going to play shortstop. He ended up playing a very nice shortstop, helped bring us to a title. And then we got some sad news a few months after the Diamond Cup was over that he wasn't coming back.
It was really disappointing. You know, he was a big part of the team. You know, I love him. He's a good guy. We played with him, you know, all the way back in the day. And, you know, I don't really know what happened. I just feel like things kind of fell apart. You know, maybe he wanted to do his own thing. He said he was going to be moving, or he wasn't really sure if he was going to come back. So we kind of had, you know, we were planning for him not to come back at that point. And then it turns out we find out that he's playing for a different team now. You know, so it was kind of a real low blow that, you know, we were able to win the championship with him. And then the next season he decides that he no longer really wanted to be a part of us. And he wanted to join his, you know, a different team. But we felt like he was the guy that, you know, should have been able to hang around. We were, you know, going to be playing with him for years.
Matt Jaklisch is just, he's a weird guy. I mean, simply put, he wasn't in our circle of friends, but we hung out with Fernudo and he would come along. And he was really into the game.
How could you sum him up? He's an interesting player. He's a guy that gives his all out there. He gives 150% every time out. Sometimes you let his emotions get the best of him. You know, his incidents are very well documented.
Yeah, at times I hated him. He's a complete knucklehead. He would start fights with other teams and then end up being friends with them. I don't know. It was hard to figure him out sometimes, but we always had him along. As a team, we always welcomed him. It was kind of weird, because after winning the championship and then having the ABA dinner afterwards, he decided to join another team he played for instead of us, and he's played many seasons with us. Then he said he was going to join the Navy or the military or something. Like, I don't know what's going through this kid's head. He was doing so well with us. We would have had another great season with him.
But when it comes down to it, he was the best shortstop that we've ever had in this franchise's history. He was a staple of the team. He was one of the original members. Again, a very clutch, timely hitter. We're going to miss him, but... You know, things happened during that offseason after the championship that there was a lot of games played, mind games, I guess you would say, and both sides mutually agreed, I think, to kind of go their own ways, to kind of part. It's unfortunate because whenever you see a core guy go, it's hard. It's hard. We often said that Matt was kind of like one of the pain in the ass of the team, but he was our pain in the ass, you know. He was like that one family member that you really just can't explain, but he's part of the family, and he's part of the Ballbreaker family. You know, he'll always go down as being one of the, you know, the best players in franchise history.
I think obviously the future for us is, you know, a lot more championships. You know, I'm planning on playing until I can't fucking walk, so... As far as I'm concerned, I feel that we're a team that should, you know, have 6 or 7 trophies lined up, you know, down the road. I feel like if we keep our, you know, core guys together, we have, you know, endless possibilities. You know, last year was nice. It was a lot of fun being in the Diamond Cup, you know, playing with all the other great teams. You know, we went 1-2. We were able to sneak into the next round after escaping the round robin.
Even till this day, you know, as I wear this championship T-shirt, you know, we went in there, we played in the Diamond Cup. We had some great experiences in there. And it felt nice to be a representative. You know, when you go out there, everyone knows that you're in that Diamond Cup because you're a champion. You know, you beat out the 6 or the 7, however many other teams there were in your division. You beat them out. You were the number one team. No one would take that away from you. We went out to the awards dinner. We accepted the trophy. You know, that was great. That was definitely another surreal moment. It was definitely a fun night, and it really cemented us as, you know, the Ball Breakers are here, we're champions. And going forward, I think that's huge for us, because now we felt that weight, we felt that pressure on our shoulder for a long, long time.
future's definitely bright. You know, we're at that age where, you know, some guys, they're into being in the best physical form. We're more dedicated to it in our personal time. For others, it's just simply having fun. And I think it's the fact that we're not as tense as we used to be gives me a lot of hope that we're going to have a lot more great seasons, if anything. We're definitely going to... I don't have any doubts that we're not going to win a championship again. We're definitely going to win another one sometime soon.
Yeah, I don't know what we're thinking. We've had a few of these. If you look at some of the team pictures, you know, we got Luigi with the Mohawk, myself, Andrew with the Mohawk. Someone had gold paint. I think that might have been Tim. Tim had the gold paint, Giuseppe. Vic had his whole head. Yeah, and this one, I had the mutton chops. We had Luigi was holding the championship belt even though we didn't win.
You know, when we first started playing...
No, we swept
them. Did we sweep them? Mm-hmm. So...
too much whatever.
I was rolling there, David.
I know, I'm sorry, but...
Go Ball Breakers.